Hey, who wears basketball? Is that me or? Yeah, it's me, the rest of the Cal State LA. Tonight, the Cal State LA Gold Eagles take on the Cal State East Bay Pioneers for the CCAA doubleheader. Welcome in, Wisconsin people. Another exciting weekend of Cal State LA basketball. Cal State LA men will take on Cal State East Bay at approximately 7:30, or 20 minutes after the conclusion of this women's game. But let's get to that women's game first as the players are on the court getting ready for this one. Well, the Gold Eagles must be retaining the Eagles match tonight with a splitting headache. Why, you ask? Because splitting has been the theme of their conference season so far. They have split each of the last four weekends in conference play, including last weekend's 64-51 victory over Cal State San Bernardino, and their 78-61 defeat against UC San Diego. The Gold Eagles' state in each game couldn't have been more different, as they never failed against Cal State San Bernardino. And conversely, they never led versus UC San Diego. Tonight begins the official start of the second half of conference play. Starting tonight, every team Cal State LA plays will be someone they played earlier this year. On that note, they beat Cal State East Bay 51-47 on December 7th in a low-scoring defensive battle. And believe me, do not expect it tonight's game to be any different than that. This could be a low-scoring battle also. This is once again another chance for the Gold Eagles to gain ground on someone ahead of them in the CCAA. They start the second half in a three-way tie for sixth place at 7-5. Their overall record coming in 10-6. But with that 7-5, they're only two games behind second place Cal State East Bay in the conference. So another big chance to move up. Because the Gold Eagles haven't been able to take advantage of those chances the last couple of weeks, using UC San Diego and Cal Poly Pomona in games where they could have moved up in the standings. Wow, let's look at the starting lineup for tonight's game. First for the visiting Cal State East Bay Pioneers. They start the same lineup as the last game, with one exception. Starting at one bright spot is another player, Stephanie Lopez, a 5'7" junior from Wilmington. He's a first-year player through the Pioneers. He has played every game. Starting with another bench comes number 22, Michael Walker, a 5'9" junior from Reno, Nevada. Rocky's in his third year with the Pioneers. He's also started every game. So it's the third guard, back number 11, Asa Finnegan, 5'8" senior from Kurok. So he obviously got away from Cal State Santa Claus. He's in his second year. Starting up for third spot is a veteran on the Pioneers in the 14th, Brianna Terrence, 5'9" senior from Palma, Washington. Terrence in her fourth year with the Pioneers. She was SCCA's second team last year. All standing up for finish time for the 54. He's the player to watch, Daniel Buchanan, 60 junior from Reno, Nevada. He was the Pioneers' leading scorer, leading rebounder, and leading stop blocker. He was in the first year. He's playing every game for the Pioneers. The head coach for Cal State East Bay, Steve Barton. He's in the fourth year at Cal State East Bay with a record of 44-57. Before that, he had 37 for the runs of Puget Sound, so he's got a long coaching career. Plus, the trivia and Emily State for all assistants. They cast it over, they're starting the same lineup they've done for a while, so you follow the Gold Eagles, you should be used to the starting lineup. Starting with the one guard, starting number 30, Paige Apollo. 5'6 sophomore from Kyle O'Reilly. Starting with the other guard, starting number 5, Emily Tevez, 5'9 junior from San Jose. Starting with the other guard, starting first the leading scorer for the Gold Eagles, number 1, Paige Melville, 5'8 junior from Kyle O'Reilly. Starting with the first guard, spot is number 15, Alyssa Beck, 5'8 junior from Carson, his senior. And let's play at the center spot, number 32, Destiny Rock-on-Turn, 6'2 senior from Simi Valley. For small guards in the third season, the third place of the Golden Eagles, and they're 56-48, 20-12 is their assistant. I'll tell you a little bit about how Simi's play after they get the score there, but first, the National Anthem is going to be played at the Eagles Nest, so I'll come back right after the National Anthem is played. This is Cal State LA Women's Basketball. Thank you. Pastor Detroit comes into the Lord's Prayer with a 12-7 record. 9-3 in the CCAA, and as I said, in second place. One game up behind first place top player Pomona in the Falcons. Obviously, Pastor Detroit is one of the best, very best teams in the CCAA this year, which actually comes as absolutely no surprise to me. If you happen to watch last year's CCAA first round tournament game between the two teams, so by the way, Pastor Detroit won here at the Eagles match. You know, the Disney Chapel, we're supposed to get about how good I thought Pastor Detroit was last year, how good they became, and how good they'd be this year, especially on defense. I did say then that the players were coming back if they were content for the conference title, and that is exactly what they are doing this year. That's the time they do it with a second turn of defense, and they only give up 60.7 points to win. Well, so exactly how good are the Pioneers? Their last clock out of Pomona got blown out by Pastor Detroit, 83-58, and one of them in two conference losses this year. Or ask UC San Diego, who the Pioneers beat 78-58 one week earlier, those are both two very, very good teams. That gives you an idea how good the Pastor Detroit team can be. The Golden Eagles are supposed to fight their world deal no matter when they have victims tonight. We start three. But they shouldn't take turns to Golden Eagles. Keep in mind, they are number one in the conference for 48% defense at 35%. Pastor Detroit, weirdly enough, with all their good defensive staff, only comes from 48% defense. But most teams do have many similar stats, including similar points to game averages, field goal percentage, and free throw percentage, which is kind of interesting. But I mentioned our rules as we go along here. This is the first two games of course this weekend. The Golden Eagles tomorrow night will take on Castle Monterey Bay, actually in a set of 5:30. So, as I said, they'll do a good omen. The only time we see Castle Monterey has swept the weekend in conference play was back on December 6th and 7th, when they defeated this Castle Monterey team and Castle Monterey Bay. So, if you're looking for any kind of good time for the Golden Eagles, maybe that's it. But Castle Monterey still after has never beaten the Golden Eagles here at the Eagles next since joining the CCAA in 2009-2010, so that's another thing to keep in mind. This is the fifth year, of course, that Pioneers were in the Division II on the CCAA as the ball skipped the year underway. Pioneers were in the black uniform, with red skin, Golden Eagles just in their white uniform, with black skin. Looks like a man-to-man defense to start the game for Castle Monterey. As Pioneers think about it, he goes, "Man, that's a really good thing to change the ball." First drop there, the Golden Eagles running the other way. Believe me, they were trying to look to run whenever they can. Pioneers want this to be a tough half-court game. Golden Eagles are going to try and get the transition offense as much as they can so the Pioneers can set up that very difficult defense. Paige Melville, they're off on Paige Melville. Rolling by 10 footers off the glass and good. So definitely off on Paige with the Golden Eagles on the board first, 2-0. Five people in the front court, almost stepping the tennis court, didn't wear the pants. And two good drivers. So they didn't get people on the side, and they got pants and scrubs. Pioneers, good player, a bit of a different starting lineup their last two games. They took out a couple of starters, Finley and Dwayne Phillips, and brought in Lisa Finnegan and Clay DeFuels, and they're a lot of smith in that lineup. But Susie Balcom came out a bit tonight, putting pants back in the lineup in place of DeFuels. Now, Tevez over to Marlborough. Marlborough back to Tevez, 3-3. Marlborough by the 2-point line, dribbles in, tipped off the tie, 8 seconds on the clock. Now, the free throw line, that's on Tevez over to Tevez, with 4. Keeps a 3-pointer, and knocks it down. So, Tevez took a big step to the left, and then found himself open and had to shoot the 3 with only 4 seconds on the shot clock. And he knocked it down. Gives the goalie with a quick 5-0 lead. Now, Lopez over to Pico, Pico's up for 3 still in that place. Apparently, that's not part of the game, and we have a new foul on the rebound called on the Pioneers. Looks like they got Michael Walker on the foul. That's the first foul for either team. Gordon Eagles is going to bring it up if they extend this good start. But as I said, the game last week was a special San Bernardino, and the Gordon Eagles never scored. So a big start certainly is key. As Lafontaine goes to bat, scored off to Marlborough, Marlborough over to Chavez. Back to Marlborough, fumbles the ball, 8 seconds on the shot clock. So once again, the shot clock laying down on the Golden Eagles. Now we know Lafontaine off to Chavez, right up into 3 in the corner, in and out. Oh, that one ripped in. and it would not stay, and the problem is it went the other way. So the bad news was, in the early game, even though he scored 5 points, I'm having trouble getting the offense going early in the shot clock. He's on drives on Lafontaine, and this left, no good. Lafontaine's the lead, I know, certainly do not put the watch in this game. Just Lafontaine versus Keaton. He's the best post player in the CCLA. That's Lafontaine leading the conference in rebounding. And he's going to turn out the game. So I thought that, for the Marvel, you know, Lafontaine came out fourth quarter, that's not close. Great pass coming the other way. 7-on-7, all the way out of the line. Bet puts up no good. Bet takes the rebound. This is a two-point lead, but that's an end. Boy, Bet looks like he had the rebound, but he took it up, and two-point was able to grab it and put it in. Well, that puts the Pioneers on the board and makes it a 5-2 back to the lead. 3 minutes into this one. Now plays a foul. Thinks better of driving. That's kicked away to Bet. Bet tries a lot of two-point. That takes a 5-foot run and puts it up and in. Nice play by Bet. He takes that 2-point to avoid the block. And then he got a step 3 and put in the little jump shot to make a 7-3. Rocker. Got it by Coach Marble. Well, maybe it's going to stay there because of Marble. But it's the way by Marble. They're going to bounce. Looks like a money ball off Rocker, but they're going to keep it with the Pioneers. Marble was turning on the bounce to see what kind of save it. He might have had time to come back in bounds and grab the ball, but he just let it go. So that's how he stays. 11 seconds on the shot clock. Now in the game of the 33 South Finley, after the Pecan, excuse me. And a foul be called, home ball, and left on turn. So they're going to single on a 2-2 out of field, 5-7. He is certainly the biggest defender they can put on Pecan. Now Finley, driving inside, two persons out, not for the ball going this far for the offensive foul. Nice defense by Paige Melville, stopping the drive and forcing Finley into the offensive foul. Finley is a 5-8 team with the name of the guy to also. Finley is like Paris, has started at the second game this year. The only 2 games he had to start was last weekend, those 2 games. That's his last time tonight. As Melville pulls up the 3 with an air ball, Finnegan might have got a piece of it. He gets the ball on the left side, in the right piece of it, and lays it up and lays it in. So those controls he can offense for the Pioneers. Pecan has all 4 points, so it's 7-4 across the way. Nice guy, guys. Fumbles the ball, doesn't sweep over right over to Marble. Back on turn, roll out of the lane, go to pass. Foul out to Marble. Marble takes the 3, drives inside, sees Pecan. There's an initial to hit the bottom of the rim. So she couldn't quite get it around, and that's where she could go over the rim. Quickly, we had a little low point. Looks at the Pecan. Third move is a back. Now, Finley. Jumped over to Lopez. Lopez got it by Trevors. 20 turned on the shot clock. Now, in low. The Steelers, he's in the game now. For the 23. Kevin Gray puts it up on top. Puts it on empty side. The Trevors are Steelers. He just took through the 5-10 sophomore from Gardena. They took this basket. There's a tie to take those shots. As Tina Fanfoy comes in for the first time for the Golden Eagles in a 21, along with Iowa working there, and in a 23. For Fanfoy, 5-6 units from Lincoln Nebraska, and Fanfoy, excuse me, Fanfoy, 5-6 units from Lincoln Nebraska, and Open Bear, 5-5 units from Sacramento. That thing to admit, so it's still a 7-6-4 legal lead. Now the third quarter, Marvel. Gets it over to Lafontaine. Lafontaine got pushed away. And a foul is called inside. Let's see what he gets the foul on. It's an offensive foul, so they say. So Open Bear committed the foul, trying to get the ball back. And that's their first media timeout. 14:48 in the first half. That's where the only reading test will be, so 7-6. This is actually the only reading basketball.
Western 38-1 was so shocked. They were going to have a tough task this weekend as they played the two teams statistically who have the best defenses in the CCAA. So they can capture the first, second, and third and point the ride for game. 60 for game. Castro Mayo, David Myers, apparently, is first in point the ride for game. So the Golden Eagles are going to have a tough time getting their offense going this weekend. With their defense, maybe they can win a couple games here. Suddenly, get to the air between the Steelers running in the air, running headshot around, and that's all players good. One shot by the Steelers. The Steelers 4 points, so that's 2 times 4 points. And the Pioneers took their first lead of the game, 8-7. Now, Brett has the ball in the first place of Marjorie, over that open barrel. That's a fast run turn into the fan ball. 25 to win before the timeout. Now, for the fan ball, the rain stops. Gets up to Brett, 4-17-48. Good! So, look for Brett playing the rain there. Backing down the line, jump shot, makes him all right. Now, the Pioneers never threw the ball. Of course, Kennedy was saved by Megan Kikoki, number 32 just into the game. I don't know if you got a bounce at the bar. I found some agreement from T-Gate Oregon. That's one of them. Anyway, that's wide open for three. A rainbow shot that they win. And I think it was rough going down lane. First kicker of the game for the Pioneers makes it 11 and 9. Maybe we're in the lead. So we've got a back and forth chart game here after the Gold Eagles. I've gotten off a good chart. Not mad there. This one there to Brett. Brett takes it up. Puts it over to five. Nice play by Brett. So Brett is going to run down to take the 2 points away. 8-6 on the field. Second team foul on the Pioneers is Brett is going to run down to take the 2 points away. And Brett does. That gives the Golden Eagles back to lead 12-11. That was 7 points on the game, so he's leading the way for the Golden Eagles. One more chance. And he's got his pressure by Rafael Green. Rafael Green, second in the CCA and Brock Tapp. Sends that one back, and Margaret comes here to work. Going to take the open goal. Same play in the corner, the good goal for. But then Greg Jesse, two Pioneers and just picked up and fouled. See, they give a foul to you, just to give it to Walker. And they do. So, two Pioneers comes back into the Pioneers. They had a chance to sit down. So, for the Pioneers, instead of them two times, Chipotle, Walker, and the Steelers. Thankful. Just a little left on chance, not the way it's going. If you couldn't break in there, they quickly wrap the other way off the front of him. They made a kick out. There was a round Brett Fontaine in the 865. Boy, that's a tough guy. That's a second foul on Brett Fontaine. Brett Fontaine in the first half. He may have to go to the bench. 3 points on the corner was an air ball. That's a good three. I'm sure that's the second half. They really stuck in on first for Brett Fontaine. And that's good ball. And a little off Fontaine. See what he can do after starting the game. Back to that Pecan. First, little 7 footer off the glass, no good. High to the lead on the front of him. Pioneers take a look at the first of the other way and look at the lead in the lead. The Pokey. This is the Steelers, 3 out of 15 footer is good. So the Steelers are 6 points already. Pioneers lead in the lead, 13-12. 8 minutes gone in this first half. And for that Margaret pulls up the three quickly, that ball is not close. Kikoki gets the rebound. Look at the pistol. Looks back to the Steelers, didn't want to shoot down. Rafontaine back and after with the 2 fouls. That's Kikoki. Over the front of the front of him. Didn't want to shoot down by Margaret. Round Margaret, winning 5 footers, no good. Rafontaine has the rebound. So we can bring it up, but the Pioneers are quickly back. A couple of subs that really took his test through the area on the next whistle. That's Anthony. Over the Marlboro. One more left on third. Pitch to that shot. He's pushed about Tucson out of bounds. So Tucson matches the black left on third one of their own. So low times and points come back into the Pioneers. The Gold Eagles in the 33 from the home is sophisticated. 5-8-2 from the Aaron Hayes. That's going to be Tyson's number 11. as well. I know. Therefore, wow, it's not no good after him. Don't feel bad for God. Don't care. He's too sad. That's the typical chapter of compared to Australia. Don't feel bad. Open door. Look at the pound inside the bag. He skipped it for the pound of the trail and then got the dead through the fire as well. That's the 15th time the pound is. The Go Biggers were inbound it with a new 32nd crack. Never pulls up for three. Man, well, God, no good. Funny three guys in there. Pulls up to Sikorsky. The Pioneers were not allowed to go through with any second penalties at all. So far, he was one and out. That's certainly much to check that off of. Now, Lopez over two times. For a 13-footer by Kansas, he's short. Tyson starts to the rebound. He's fouled by Sikorsky. Throw it over the back. That's a 16 foul, so it'll be very hard. But the next play down, the Pioneers are out of fouls. And Finnegan is back in for the Pioneers. So Melville will slowly bring the ball into the front court. That's that play over to Melville. That Bruce Parsons pulls up for an 18 footer, and that's a down. So Bruce Parsons back down the first part of the game. That's a good sign. Off the bench to get the goal, they got the lead 14-13. Got a Pistons to Kirkley, and Bruce Parsons got a little too close with him, sadly. So, first time in Parsons, definitely the same, excuse me, 15 time to go to Eagles. So, Finley comes back into the Pioneers to Kirkley with 6 lines. Finley does provide quite a punch off the bench for the Pioneers. And in the front court. Finley got knocked away in the head, stays at the passing, great play by the head. And that Magra coming the other way, gives that to the head. Over in the corner, three pointed by Stanton, it was no good. They're knocked away out of bounds, stays, goes to Magra there. Magra gives that to Parson. Parson runs over that play, boy, Luke Whistle. That's a foul. That was a late whistle. They called the offensive foul. So their team is 16,000. Their team is 10 out of the floor. 150 remaining with first half. Basket area has a lead of the Jackson Retreat. It's only 14-13. This is Basket Area winning basketball.
This is only taken there. It's a bit tough. It's a tough catch. 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 It's a tough. It hasn't been too successful for this year, but she makes that one. Kentucky comes back in for the Pioneers.
in an open barrel. Looking to get the gold medal, there's a 2-point lead, and that one got the win there. And now the Pioneers coming the other way. Quickly in the fourth quarter. Bam! Back in there, taking it away round two. Panthers winning, but that ball is taken on the way. Panthers back to this ball, and the Panthers after this, the Pioneers. You know, Bill's running around and hit 5 points on the rebound, man. Seems like there's some contact, and Panthers trying to get the rebound. There's no power. Never a 6-1. Panthers looking for a 5-2, did not get one. The Panthers still open there, and had Panthers on the left. He's pretty good at it. Took it himself, and missed a lot. Paul Lopez. It's the 3 defenders, and the ball is stolen by Panthers. Pickers can't do the work to go Google. After at least Bridger Williams who raised it up and in. So Bridger Williams in the way area for 7 pistons and tags there after that. He's the fourth Australian player on the Go Google roster. As I believe, Castillo misses a shot to keep handling and fouled. So Bridger Williams has not seen much action lately. He did get a basket. I believe it was against San Bernardino. Second ball in the second foul. The Seals are going to run 2-2. Three-four is good. The Seals, as a freshman, led the CCAA in draft last year with 30. This is only his third start of the year. So that thing is good also. Beth comes out into the room with nothing there to the left. So if I need to put that pressure, a rocket into them. Sanford breaks it easier in the front court. What it's going to do is just pick up the dribble and give it to Bart. Now the dribble gives a loose shot and turns into 15 lead. Now Bridger Williams over to Bart. Back to Williams, takes the three. For a person, you know that he was Sanford, but this isn't a lot of these teams that are awesome. Now that he's not there, he's right there, that's the better way. In the lane, running up the lane with Bill, and that's the standard. Holding power, but he missed the shot, and he can't knock it out of bounds for the 2-4-0. There's 7:41 left to go, and Bill Eagles will bring it up. Holding on to a 2-point lead. So, it looks like Bill in the first point. He handles the ball in this shuttle. This will be open Bill. Oh, Bridger Williams got left about. So you have two big men there, really. The Pistons will pull up the 3-4-1. That's the ball! So two Pistons in the second basket of the game in the sixth point. Bridger Williams is a 5-point lead. Now he said that was too physical. And I'm there. I'm the Steelers. And she was close to the foul. That's only the first foul. That's the 18th foul to go Bridger. So it'll be a 1-1 for the Steelers. And he took out the free throw line. So the Steelers made two out of three free throws in the game. Really, right on that one. 7-3 by the Pistons. And it looks like they might have had a foul on us. So a tough thing to go through the Steelers with the rebound. It's the third foul on Pistons. So it's going to have to come out as Marvel comes back in. So Michael Rackley will go to the lane. Rackley is the CCA freshman of the year in 2011-2012 as a second year third year with the Pioneers. He misses the free throw, so he looks one and one, but that goes out of bounds and will finally go to South Carolina. So the Golden Eagles will quickly bring it up to 7:20 remaining in the first half. So the 20-15 lead now in the half. That's the only Marvel. Wild pass. Now that's coming out of Williams. Now Marvel fouls the line. Two defenders. Quick with Wildly. Williams wins the ball. Marvel through the ball. Seems too easy to throw it to. It will stay out of bounds. Now on the 24th first round for the first place of the game. 5-16 with the Lincoln Nebraska. So he's in there with a 26th defender. That was Margaret Bell in the hair thing in the game. the high nose of their toes was so cold. Rips it over his toes. For a 19 footer, they're dead. Rebound goes out to Lopez. So the high nose are getting second chances. And then I thought, sorry, their Eagles are getting them. As a three pointer is good, no good, excuse me, going out of bounds, and the judge got a bounce, and Walker tried to save it. So they're two cross in our eyes. Yeah, three points for them. Three and a half points. That would be some good if he didn't get the first down for us. Oh, they got the third to please Marvel. That's fast, and they got the first, and the final was able to intercept it, and a foul was committed to stop the fast break. So the head to the football foul. That's the 10th team foul already, though, so I'd be two free throws for the Pioneers. Lopez is getting around, he's two. Lopez makes the free throw, that was two free throws. Tucson didn't realize it. Lopez is the ball handler for the Pioneers, so he's getting 4 assists a game. That was third in the CCLA this year, so that's average of two steals a game. Every player pretty much on the Pioneers team is very good defensively. I do not believe we're finding weak points defensively on this team. As the field comes back in, my ball. Over to Marvel. Marvel dribbling on a stop with a red jam. Time out by Jamal Jones for a red ball for us. Look at the Pioneers and taking the ball away, but the assistant heard Jamal Jones call time out. And they gave it to us. That could be a 6:30 time out. And we'll be able to success the other women's basketball. That's where they cut the number two, which is a good sign. They're playing during the timeout, so maybe hanging one in the background from time to time. As the Golden Eagles are in the front court with a 3-point lead. That's the one in Marvel over the back. That in the near corner over the first time play. First time play, a foul on the cross. We're going to Marvel almost over the head with three. With two, the turns up set. Who's with the back with the ball? It'll be a shot clock violation. Good defense there by Captain Sterling once again. Third Eagles have the two game first sisters out there, along with Third Marvel with the ball to him in the front of the half. Lopez brings the ball up in the front court for the Pioneers. He has had the ball in the goal of the game, as I said, he will make ball handling. As Terrence gets rid of the series, that Finnegan after a two time, so pretty much they're starting well back out there. Now another two time, got by the half. Then another Terrence. First to Staten and had seen a fanfare and it's after three for them to miss the layup. Fanfare quickly going the other way and giving out the three. That two on first turn pass in the way of their three or hit the ball. And out of bounds, the pass was not quite there. Paul had the defenders threw it off. The pass wasn't quite on target, they didn't have any too much pressure on it. So a turnover was pretty good move there. And all the Pioneers are getting in the front court. And Charlie gets in the front court over there. So he's getting the foul trying to put him. Boy, if you had two of them coming behind him, he just could have known maybe some 20 inches or something. He just could have given him the ball to probably get out of there. If you want to stop, we'll go to the free throw line. So the first time for him, it's an interest to kind of take the free throw line. This is the free throw. First on the road, that would be about 2.5 points a game. He plays about 17 minutes a game. And that free throw is no good. That's hit nicely by Dalton. First point for David Dorbingo's run into Boston. And now they're going to only 5 minutes to go in the first half. Not both. This is in fact just got the three. Not the first. First drive in the early area. What kind of really? No good. They haven't seen that shot before. But David Dorbingo's a third chance. So finally, to make up the rebound to the Golden Eagles, well, Marvel back down and throws it away. really nowhere to go. She's back on CMS. She has time out for interviews. So she had more late for the media timeout. 4:35 in the meeting was first half. And it's a 30-second timeout. So we'll keep it here. So as I expected, this has been a still-going offensive half for both teams. Defense is certainly good today. Especially for the Pioneers, their leaders have had numerous possessions where they've run the shot all the way down. Had to take some cuts back. As a 4:35 inning was first half. For the Bermudas, this is an important stretch for the year. As each becomes a stretch of six of their last 10 games to endure right at the Eagles match to finish the year. And this is a hard season when these teams played on December 7th. Gold Eagles had the final for their season worth 27 points. Pioneers are also 8-14 from 3-point range in that game. That's the only home loss that Cascade East Bay has had so far this year. More of a team keep in mind the charge back then is down to 60 points all year. So they're going to have to be sold out the Gold Eagles defense as well. That's why this could be such a big defensive battle. And the Pioneers having coming in front court, Lopez getting back to Pecan. But the Steelers up there, almost throwing away Cinnamon out there with J.I. Chance. That was stopping the by the Gold Eagles. And here's the chance. Picking up Blair's the air up, 6-5. Four Gold Eagles are around. They're taking a turn by Tazer Powell. That's four there by Tazer. Went on four the other way. Still got two of them play. And the Gold Eagles are reset. Tazer Powell over the Powell. And a hair. That is left in significant more. It's a real bad pass. That was not open. Picked off and Cinnamon comes the other way. So both teams are offensive drive here of late as the poor 13-footer is no good. Here's a tie ahead of the four in hand. That's the chance. Now the Pioneers are going to reset. That's it. I think it's going to do it to give them more to Cinnamon. Cinnamon looks to pass up to Lopez. Lopez, they're not going to about him. They will stay with Cascade East Bay. As they report the clear lead, they took this to pass to the Gold Eagles. 5-6 freshman to the Rangers. Lead has made some nice offensive contributions lately. Finley back into the Pioneers, turns out to Pico on 4 seconds on the clock. Here after Finley with three, with one, he has to shoot a wide 25-footer, and they're good. That's a shot-out violation for Larry Bear. Gold Eagles still up one night on defense. So, 3:15 remaining, Gold Eagles are going to point. They can extend this 3-point lead. Well, the score has stayed this way for a while, 20-17. Now, here's the bet. They're letting the hair almost back away. The hair is going off it. Somehow gets it. And the ball is tied up, but the position will keep it with that for their own. So, that's the area we did. Have it with 10 seconds on the shot clock. So I'll have to be aware of that shot clock. Now Marbury with six. Gets it over the Missouri lead with four. And the way he puts, he's put a good bit, but he is fouled. So nice play right away by Missouri lead to draft some free throws. So Missouri lead will go to the free throw line. Lead on the year up to about 4 points a game on average. He misses the free throws. He's only a 37.5% free throw shooter on the year, but he has not been there very often. He's only averaged about 10.5 minutes a game, even in the 7th grade of the year. He misses the second free throw. So he misses that for the Gold Eagles and stays at 20-17 passing away lead. By Lopez, the Gold Eagles is starting out with a 2-3 zone. Same way to Cunningham. Whips over to Finley. Finley whips across court to Finnegan, turns up for three in the corner. they're good friends, they don't get it. They throw their pass, and suddenly they throw their turn to pass. But they're offended behind. The fool tells to skip it, and Matthias calls. That's a 10 team pass, so that will be 2 free throws to create the pass. Both teams in the double bonus. So the fool's got the foul. That's their third foul. So a couple of players in five double with both teams. There's a foul going around to 2 free throws. Here's the power as usual. Had a steady, consistent weekend last week to make the free throw. Terrence and Sikorsky come back into the power rows. Powell had identical numbers in both games. He had 10 points and 2 rebounds. And so a 2 assists in one game and 1 assist in the other. So basically the same stat line for both games. That's their full consistency all year. He's been running the point for his last few weeks as a starter. Taking over the ball handling duties on the team, and he's had it in his capable hands. Not a fortunate, the Golden Eagles turnovers have been down since he's taken over. That is an offensive foul right there. So the only thing, that's why Paige Melville with their first foul. Another nice play by Melville, it's about the same place as Jared Brown in his first half. So now he's going to 2 minutes from here, back in the game. He's got to take the foul. Powell at the back. Starts rising side, picks out the Melville. Wide open for 3 on the ring. That's the down. The guy comes out after, and we've got some big Melville finally getting the first basket of the game. I think playing it, it's a 25-17. For Paige Melville, in the top 10 of the conference, a 3-point percentage. 33% on the year, is an offensive foul there. So the Golden Eagles defense really pulling up here. The person just hit those guys, so the Pioneers are in foul trouble here. So the corner lead is getting around to see 2 more free throws. And in and out, the 2 goals came from the line. He's going to take time right now. Michael Rocker comes back into the Pioneers. So Reed looking to go on the scoreboard and get a first point here at the free throw line. No good. Mahan gets the rebound there. That's the rebound. Took a foul. He's directed by Tucson, but a foul is bad. They say he likes to get the draft. He got it with the body. So Reed is talking the basket and they're right back to the free throw line 2-3. So for the last 10 years, they're in the first half of the Golden Eagles going to playing time with McClure and Reed. The front of the half, especially with 8 minutes already in this first half. Plays like Jordan Williams also, so Golden Eagles getting some competition from everybody. Finally, Reed makes a free throw for the first point. Golden Eagles were the biggest lead of the game, looking to make it in the double digits. That one barely went to the end. So 26-17. Lopez is barely being in the front court. Jack Finnegan gets a little rapper. Got a piece on him. Terrence throws up for 3, and that's the down. So finally, a 3-pointer goes down for the Pioneers. It's a 26-20. That was only the second 3-pointer of the game, I believe. As Melville takes up the game, he's staying there good. He gets the rebound, he loses it, gets it tied up, and will get there to rest the world there to see the top 30 score. So Reed couldn't get rid of it because he's tied up. Pioneers are very effective in cutting into 6-point deficit for them as we're under a minute to go in the first half. Now Rapper turns up the front of him. Tucson gets it over to Lopez and where to Terrence. Pull up 8-3, it was good. So Brianna Terrence, the official stopped play for some reason. Another basket for her. So Terrence is her first point. Now 25 seconds left. Top off about 5 seconds out of the game clock. 26-22. Wow, fumbles the ball. Still plenty of time. Now he's jumping up down to 10. Margaret with the ball. Mazda was 7, 12 on the game clock. Mazda, I thought that the tire was 4 or 3. Then the road took a wild stop, no good to figure it out. With 3 seconds on the stop clock, to close the tire, making it happen, but to the very end of the stop clock, and still go to the free throw line, looking to get the Golden Eagles back a 6-point lead. Paul Miller only 2 free throws earlier in the half. So, save the power. So, I said, she's certainly all over the shot. She's most games. Points, rebound, assist. She's a very good rebound with her goal. And that free throw is good. She's a very good rebound with her goal. Guard, forward, and center. But to be a guard makes it especially impressive. As Kyle is going to make it a 6-point lead. Once she does. 7.1 seconds remaining, 28-23. Now, Kennedy gets almost a half point. After Walker with 4. Now, Kennedy with 3 with 2. Peacon set. Now, Kennedy with 3. Well, I just thought she had no good penalty kickback is after the buzzer. So that will take us to halftime. So, Casper there is up pretty much the entire half. But after a good shot at 5-0, their defense really ruled the game in this one, more so than their offense. They had Casper in third and set. He's throwing inside about 33% for that first half. So a very impressive display defensively for Castro Valero, both for both teams. But Castro Valero, with not as big as a 9-point lead, comes into the halftime leading by 6. So that will take us to halftime. Castro Valero leading Castro Valero, he's 28-22. I'll take a break for about 10 minutes. I'll be back then with scores and other games down the CCRA. First half dropped on the beginning of the second half. First, this class of all wins basketball. any cash time with the Eagles. And for the cash time with the Eagles, they're leading the cash time with the Eagles 28-22 after a very impressive defensive display in the first half by Cash State LA. Not very often you can say Yacht played the best defensive team in the conference on the defensive end, but I think that's what the Gold Eagles can throw in the first half. Let's see if they can keep the ball in the second half. Let's take quickly the halftime stats. Pioneers got 8 of 25 in the first half, only 32%. Gold Eagles were only slightly better, 9 of 24, 37.5%. Pioneers were 2 of 8 from 3-point range, Gold Eagles were 3 of 10. Passing the third, did not get to the free throw line much, they're only 4 of 7. The Gold Eagles didn't take advantage of the opportunity when they did get there. They were only 7 of 15. They would have a bigger lead if they'd made the free throws. Rebounding is about even, 21-19 in favor of the Gold Eagles. Bench points are even after 9-8. Turnovers are certainly a big story in this first half because both teams play much more defense and had a lot of turnovers. Cash State East had 12 of them in the first half. Cash State LA had 4 and 2 had 10. So both teams certainly plugged with turnovers in the first half. As far as the scoring, it was pretty balanced for both teams. So, Pioneers, they were in the trend by 12 of Steelers, who had 8 points. They had a chance at 5 points. Daniel Coutan only had 4 points. The leading score for the Pioneers were only 4 rebounds. That's significant. Lisa Fulton had 3 points, and Stephanie Lopez had 2 points. Well, Castro LA, they played a lot of players and a lot of scoring. Just about where they were with 7 points. Steve Parsons had 5 points off the bench. Chase Apollo had 3 points. And then Sevens and Green Star Page Marvel had 3 points. Justin Rockland Third had 2 points. Georgia Williams had 2 points. And as did Justin Rockland Third, I said, 1 point from the Taylor Reed and Ayuk and Vera. Georgia Williams played plenty of plays in that first half. 16 players played in the first half for Cash State LA. So there were plenty of contributions. There were a couple of stretches in that half where there were no points at all. About a 30-minute stretch right in the half where nobody scored any points. So it seems to get really start the second half here. Well, the motion, of course, for the next match has to be the Mount Mary to get started by our day. That was starting about 5:30. Just remember, there's 13 after this one's over. The moment is coming up at this cross rating, so that should be an exciting game. Probably high scoring in this one. Although I said that about last year's men's game, and it ended up being a race game during the Cash State LA loss. But to go to the women on the road, after this weekend, they do go on the road to face number 10 San Francisco State. But as I said, playing tonight, 6 of their last 10 games right here at the Eagles' Nest. So that's good for trying to improve in the conference, as they come in this game in a 3-way tie for 6th place. So this is an important game of depth. Gets over to Casey Powell. 35% of the game starts taking off for the Gold Eagles. Has bad pass by depth, taken over by Jones, another turnover. Now, Finnegan. In the front court. Pioneers look like they're playing their same drive as part of the game, also. Driving all the way left there. Up and under the line, Powell misses the layup. Powell gets the rebound. Quickly puts it the other way. He finally needs a dunk, so Powell has to throw it up. And restart the offense for Cash State LA. Now Paige Magwell over to Chavez. Chavez over to Casey Powell. Powell looking for someone to get it to. Gives her a dunk. Now Magwell takes the 3-7 on the shot clock with 6. Ready to go. They made it off that team with 3 balls. Out of contact, no foul called. And the Pioneers are going the other way. Now Rockwell looking to push it quickly. Maybe a director from their coach to push it together. That blocked the shot out of bounds by Cage. That's blocked by Alyssa Belt. Remember, she's one of the leading shot blockers in the conference to also, along with Dusty LaFontaine. Gold Eagles lead the conference and block shots. As Rockwell drives the lane, all the way puts it up, no, but still going to the line. Belt and Casey Powell both there, and they're going to give the foul to Casey Powell. That's his second foul. So what are they going to keep too? He makes the first free throw. So that's the first point for either team in the second half. So after the first part of the game, he makes the second part of the game with that free throw. That makes a 4-point game once again, 28-24. Now, Douglas, first can only get in, especially stolen by Citizens. He's trying to go for that time frame. And now that ball knocked away by Dalton, stolen by Douglas, so matching corner was on the other end. I said, both these teams really impressive with their defense. That's quite frankly, have not looked pretty on either side of this game. Rick Bell Edgar, quite frankly, but that's in no small part because both teams are great defense. The fourth player is up and good by Douglas. So a big tackle by Douglas. His second basket of the game, he has 6 points, which is 31-24. Now the front court, giving off the chance, that's going around the rafters. One more Pecan. Pecan drives underneath, got no good, but gets the rebound. Now Powell looking to push it the other way. Off the third Madwell. Now Powell will reset the offense. Now it's over to Bart. Bart is low to Madwell, kicks over to Douglas. Drives the lane, three pioneers the door, and then they call a foul. So Douglas is kind of out of control, which is a bad out there. See if they get the foul on. John Pecan, that's a huge foul. That's their third foul. So they're going to take a lot as the Spurs will come back in. So a big foul there. Pecan has not really gotten going this whole game. And they have to sit down for a while now. As Madwell gets it in their left on turn, barely before the foul count is up. Now that's on turn over the Cowboys. So I said Pecan is only 4 points to play this game. Not bad. And then left on turn, there by the Spurs. That's a size mismatch. And 50 points for Madwell. Here's it up and in. First pass from left on turn. Right to Kevin Hayes Madwell. That's the second basket of the game. 5th point, gives the Golden Eagles a 9-point lead back, which matches the biggest lead of the game. That's all. And underneath Farrell and John getting knocked over for a foul off on turn on the ground. It was Finnegan for the Pioneers. So he might be on the floor and they think they call the foul and off on turn. They do. That's a big foul. That's a third foul, I believe. That's a third foul. Kieran actually said 4 fouls, but I believe it's a third. As Casey Calhoun's going around to see the third foul. Excuse me, before the hair comes in. And now a foul will be called here. So it'll be a new start foul. And Michael Rapper, dragging the ball back to the Golden Eagles. So the Golden Eagles are 2 players with 3 fouls now. 3 persons are now resting back on turn with 3 fouls. That Bart gives it to Nahara. In low to Tina Fanfare. Raise it up off the rim. No good. Nahara fights for a new star. Jeff will close it. Somehow goes to Madwell. Finnegan didn't see it. Finnegan falls down. But I don't know how he seems to a new star. That was a bad pass by Madwell. Luckily goes off the Pioneer. That's still going to turn over. Finley aims to pass for a new star. So the Golden Eagles are 25 seconds on the clock. That third Madwell will inbound it. Somebody will lift it back. Not bad. Nice to see a fan for it, but third Madwell has made a couple of very bad passes in this game. He's got to take better care of the ball. He has it right now. Pulls up for an 18 footer and it backs up a little bit. Heads back to the rear. Pick it up and pitch it on. Nice play by his son of hell. He caught over the defender and put him the rebound for his first pass of the game. That's a real good time. Gives the Golden Eagles the biggest lead of the game, 35-24. The 17 footer, no good by the Spurs. The Golden Eagles start out the second half strong with Pedro. Touch the ball at the door to Tina Fanfare. He's accidentally dumped by Lopez and fouled. So the Golden Eagles start out the second half by scoring the Pioneers 7-2. From the lead. That's certainly the way we're going to see Cash go away, second half, if you're a Golden Eagle fan. second foul on Lopez. Pioneers with 3 fouls already. Melville is fully bringing in the first quarter, 15:40 remaining. Not bad. Gets over in the hole. Yeah. Whips it over to the front for us. Pioneers with 2-3 zone. Don't put it on the clock. That's Anthony pulls up on the wing for three. It almost wedges in. It's so good. Timber will bring it into the front court quickly. Didn't let it stand. Harris, the odd dart, picked up no good. Tipping the ball, first to Finnegan. Paige Melville bumps the ball with the loose ball. And so the foul will be called on Paige Melville. That's only the first foul, so she's not going to get that foul trouble. Each team has 18 fouls. Kind of a bash to pass today. 10 players have scored so far in this game for the Golden Eagles. Out of the 12 that have played. Brooklyn Bell comes back into the Golden Eagles. He played 7 minutes in the first half. Had 2 rebounds and 1 point. The first fumble is the bear. Now picked the arm. Clarence gets one of the Finnegan. Underneath for Spears. Touched by the hand. No call. Rebound goes up to Clarence. He blows the way up and the hand gets loose fast. I think there's a really right in play right now. And it's Tina Thompson bringing in the front court. So Tina Thompson just got the belt. Over to Chavez. Chavez pulls up the three and tries to go over the dunk and knocks it down. So two big three pointers for Chavez here in the second half. That's his third three pointer of the game. So that's our man of his points. He has three of the 5 Golden Eagle threes in the game. As Lopez goes inside and is bumped and fouled by Chavez. So the Golden Eagles going into this first media timeout with 14:21 remaining. Extending their biggest lead of the game, finally taking care of this one. 14:21 left in this second half. Cascade Oilers, 38-24 lead in the Cascade East Bay. This is Cascade Oilers women's basketball. Remaining in this second half. That's the way after a very impressive start in the second half. Leading by 6 at halftime, they're now leading by 14. So Lopez goes to the line and she bounces one in. Lopez is a third point. As I said, Lopez is the ball handler for the Pioneers and she makes the second free throw. That makes it 38-26. That first court pressure. With that first Chavez, wow, he throws it in the front court. Two or four court tries to get it, they just take it over by Finnegan. So a turnover for the Golden Eagles. Now Lopez kicked it in the front court. Triple team. He's got the Finnegan. Finnegan in the lane. Looking for someone to get it to. Big man in Chavez. Chavez can find her own bench. Whips the cross court to Lopez. Dangerous to run over to Finnegan. Can't take it by the front court. Golden Eagles go after that. He's got a stagger. And there, so great defense for Cascade LA. Pioneer Tiger rotates the ball side to side and they did not win. Yeah, Tina Fonso. Look at the center of the group, he's going to have to bet. Bet is quickly going into the front court. Off the page of Magler. Pioneer with a bet, no shots on the hair. Bet picked up the front. Wow, it's got a number of crosses on there. Bet just, she's left them there, gets the back. And a hard ball is called, boy, that was quick. That was a really quick hard ball. And it gives the ball back to the Pioneers. the pioneers that bring it up. As we are under 1340 to go in this second half. Now the front court Pentagon has the ball. Kicked over to Bashir. Bashir gets on the tunnel. Tunnel's really low up. There's no good. Heading for the ball. Boy, two of the four players are not going to be by Bashir. They get the step shot. It was his right thing between the back and the backboard. Yeah, I should have thought earlier that we didn't need it there, Mr. Ward. So that's the best guys to get it out. That ball did run. So they're going to have to get another basketball probably. Now the cheerleading squad going up. So if they look at the cheerleader pulling back the ball out, this is something we'll see every day. As the cheerleader knocks the ball off the basket. How about that? And they're doing it down. So that's an interesting. That's the way the cheerleader's doing their part. Get the loose ball. That there's the money turnover, but the rest of our favorite catch for the race, so they end up with a belt in the back court. They're in the play. You got Greg Burke at that time out, and it's just not for them. They think it's the Pioneers. But if they're not that bad at times, they say no, they're going to have threat. So if they're playing, they hope the cast of these four, and you can feel the momentum starting to turn a little bit. Even though the Greg Burke has a 4-point lead, it's just like Texas, and they're effective to cast of these four. As the Texas is back in the game as the ball. Pounded by Paige Margaret, just for their fans. To see his first up inside the goal, to a goal by the hair. To see Lenny moving on the hair, and they call a foul on the floor as to no basket. Second foul on the hair. So there are several possible players with just 2 fouls, at least 2 fouls now. There are only 2 or 3 fouls, so nobody in very serious fouls ever left. Finnegan. So, Metro Fairbank and Barra. There's the defense of Alouette and Barra. These teams do that many, many times. Margaret puts 2 defenders and loses the ball. This is not the East Bay Tales, loses Lopez, and will go to the goal leader. It's 24 on the shot clock. So, Margaret's going to make something happen on her own. She's only 2 of 9 shooting in the game. What a 6-3 point lane. Two-time comes back in 4 to 5 years. That's incredible considering Hope's 3 points of time that year, under 20%. He's in the top 10 of the conference in both categories, but I'm taking a serious hit tonight. And feels the ball right now. Guys, the lane. No good, but still go to the line. Chris Magler averaging 15 points a game on the year, which is about 7th in the conference. Remember, he's had flipped a bit over the last couple of weeks. So maybe this is expected a little. I see where one point near the top of the conference is scoring, but they said he's down to 7th in scoring, so he's 9th in field goal percentage, about 48% of games. He was much higher in the conference about a week or two ago. And that free throw is no good, because he misses a free throw, too, and he's, of course, a very good free throw shooter. 76.5% on the year. So, unfortunately, a lot of his numbers have taken a dip. If he makes that free throw, let's see if he can get it going in this last 4:49. The goal being agreed by 13, 39-26. Now Lopez jumped it over to Finnegan as a fan fell for defense. Lopez throws up 4-8-3 and that's the down. So a free throw by Lopez, 7 points of the game, makes that 10-point game, bringing on the 21. There's still a lot of game left, and the 3 points kept to come by in this game. Well, yeah, they're starting to see the fan for us. Not my goal. The game is really slowed down, even more so on the first half, I'd say. On the hand, whips a little bit, dangerous pass. Ball tried to dribble it and lost off the foot. Lopez coming one on one right away, picks up the coupon, puts up to his side by seeing the fan for him, took over the line. And that's one thing, take the call, it's coming out here for the trip. They seem to be getting out after that, though. All the momentum is with the Pioneers. That's exactly what she's going to do. She calls the timeout. 11:50 left in the second half. We'll take a big fight. Castellari's lead has been whittled down to 39-29. This is Castellari winning basketball. and especially where this first half in the second half, it's possible this second half is the lowest scoring in the first half. Their Eagles have scored the Pioneers so far, 11-6. Pioneers are a rare home shooting in the second half, so the goal of the defense has turned up even more. It's pretty incredible. As good as the goal of the in the first half, Pastor Lord can lose from 4-8 in the second half. Stupak makes the free throw. That's a pretty good percent for the game, over 40%. Pioneers for the game are down to 25%, but they're starting the game from the free throw line. As well as 66 from the line in the second half, those two free throws. It's a 39-31. Now, Brett, what's going on there? That's the first point that Pico has scored since early in the first half. That's the first 4 points of the game, actually. So, he has not been hit them for a long time. That Fanfare gets up the Melville funded. He gets it. Well, Tanya's contesting every pass. 5 seconds on the set back. In the range, he's through the funded. He picks it up, throws it up to him, and they're able to figure it out. With 3 seconds on the set back, there's a missing move by Paige Melville. To really step up the defense and end up kicking the free throw line. So, Finnegan gets his second pass. Melville, who's made one of the first 2 free throws, will go right back to the line. First down. Looking to get a point any way she can. He's still well under the season average of 15 points a game. Second free throw, where is the line at all? So, 2 missed free throws and 2 kicks down to Paige Melville. 40-31. Now Lopez over to Finnegan. That's the Lopez who had a 3-point a minute ago. Which one of the 2 points? That's all. That kind of 3-point that's a pokey is not close. Barely with the backboard. Open Bear looking to push it the other way. Pioneers are back. Open Bear gets it back. Jack Finnegan picks it up. Wow, he's trying to put it on the rear after that board. The only time he gets the least bad, 2 points would not let her get it. That's the Lopez, and the Pioneers are. Turn it up. The coaching the left hander off the center again is whipped around the perimeter. Wow, 12-foot runner. They do the Lopez up there and rebound. Just it up and puts it in. And the hand kind of fell asleep there. He actually gets the rebound. But he did not box out Lopez. He got his own rebound. And put it back up to the right point. This is the first that the Pioneers have been since halftime. 40-33. And that fire spot inside, and Bruce Sanford is trying to put that door in. He's not allowed to move through the paint without resistance, which of course just really is a violation. Michael Walker steps in for the Pioneers, spoke with Chicken. 13-16 fouls. So that's a red foul. Everybody's got a foul, so it'll be free throw for both teams left to do. One door, dangerous pass. That was super clean. And a hard part of the retro goes through the Pioneers. Paige Melville should not have made that pass. That was not open. And it results in another pass to Larry Fanover. So Ralph Fontaine comes back into the game. But she's been sitting out of the line with those 3 fouls. The hair is took down. So the Golden Eagles with 16 turnovers in the game. So both teams are heavy on the turnovers because this is a problem that's actually already had, especially early in the year, that really bothered them in a few games. And they're clearing out for the Thunder, and a timeout called by Stevie Bacon, who had done well the turnover. So 10-1 remaining, we'll take the 6-4, possibly early up by 7. This is actually a women's basketball. Center on the morning in the second half. So this game, the Golden Eagles have led the entire game. They're led by as many as 14 in the second half. They're led by 6 at halftime. Pioneers are slowly slipping away at the lead. And it's close to 7. Through a fan throw with the foul. And Michael Walker going to the line. I'll take us to the media timeout, I believe, at 9:51 remaining, so another timeout on the floor. Don't go anywhere. This could be an interesting finish. Class A with a 30-17 lead over Class A East Valley. This is Class A women's basketball. I'm going to put you on the money in this second half. I'm going to go to the left. I'm going to go to the line for a fast 30 story. 2-2-3 throws. Kyrie is trying to cut even further into the 7-point lead as Walker makes the first free throw. Walker's 3-4 from the line. He's got made free throw for his 3 points in the game. No point for fast 30 story in double figures. With that free throw, the Pioneers for the game. Well, it's 12 of 15 shooters from the free throw line, but 8 of 8 in this second half. So that is really bringing them back where they could not get to the free throw line in the first half. They are getting there with regularity in this second half. They've got right away, Margaret Ruffer adjusted. Still 16 seconds on the shot clock. Bob Western Ruff on turn. Big Tyson checked back in during that time out. Margaret looks to Dallas. Goes inside, and a foul is called, an offensive foul. See their depth. That's good if that's off on time. And it is. That's a third foul. Oh, boy. So he just stepped back in. Picks up the fourth foul. So, put that with the comeback out. That's huge. With 9:37 remaining. Turn the half. Comes back in for it. We see how long Greg Jones can keep her on the bench. And that's 2-4-4 Peyton Margot. I work in there. B. Parsons on the turn the half. That's going to go Google. Michael Rocker, Daniel Pecan, Stephanie Lopez, Jan Ferris, and Rachel Finnegan for the Pioneers. Like Lopez, look for the Pecan. Pecan throws up for a long 2-pointer, no good. Margaret, that's the rebound, good. Finnegan kind of pushed off and got away with it. They get the refill, that's the pass. Found Mahara there and didn't shoot. Martinez throws up for 3, no good. Finnegan gives the Pioneers a third chance. But that's where the offense there, and they play the Pioneers. So once again, offensive rebound covering the Gold Eagles, they take it to each ball. As Oakland Brewer sits down and lifts the belt, will come back in for that very reason to get some rebounds. As Pecan looks over to Walker. Walker kicks it inside the feet. The ball takes, excuse me, over the hair, 7 foot of no good. That was fast back there over the hair, and the ball goes to Peyton Margot. Margot will bring it around and stop the offense. Still 8:40 remaining, just took a half, so plenty of time. It's only a 5-point game. That's one of those teams in a scoring drive. Neither one scoring for the Wild. Underneath the ball, Matt DeRay down at the feet of Brad Knight, staying at center for us. And Matthew Taylor, this has been an injury good defensive game. This has been a crappy game, too. There's been a lot of terrible positions right now. So that error in those turnovers was because of their defense. Margaret, maybe I'm not as overstrained the defense. So we're going to see what they got to do. That's played on Margaret for a round of the center with a good throw at 9 points. But the 42 to 35. So it's kind of fairly 7-footer, no good. So that's a third foul in the head. Somebody sees him there because just the off on turn, that's 4 fouls. So it's kind of to go to the line. That's the point of that. So, as I said, the Pioneers have not missed a free throw in this second half. That is keeping them in the game, 9-for-9. Second free throw is good. That's 6 points for Kansas. I was saying that football precedent, 42-37, Peter Fonseca going into football easily. But I don't know, at least in my head, back to Fonseca, and that's kind of good. It's a bad layup. All by himself, he couldn't make the layup. Wow. Wow, what's the result of a three-point game in the Peacock, right by the hair. Peacock driving the baseball, kicked out the Rocker. Rocker pulls up for 17 foot away on that. Three passes hit for rebound. Parsons brings in the front foot around in the hair, turn. So both teams having a tough time going to get the club bad there. Let's see if she can go down. And there's nothing on the mid basket of traveling by Ocean Head. No, girl's not happy with that guy there. Look at she might have kept her pivot foot there. I got a little about that. I've seen worse than that, not bad traveling. But it goes in the corner if they don't move it, unfortunately. So they still have a 5-point lead. 7-15 and 8 in the second half. And this second half is seen at a peak power at this close third pace. As it's got no good. Peacock pushed it up and then on their rebound. She was weak further. Alyssa Bett got that and put it in. Makes it 42-39. That bet just from Nagra for being in the front court. She threw the fingers and she was fouled. So that's finally the 17th foul. It's not very fair. That'll be a 1-1 for Alyssa Bett. So Lopez is hopeful of five. Third Eagles have been called for 9 fouls already. Here's a pass coming back into the Red Eagles. We haven't seen him in a while. What a surprise. By the turnovers, I think it's either going to be sooner than he's handed the ball over duty. So big free throw for Douglas. He made it on the free throw earlier. Free throw is no good on the 1-1, and Peacock gets the rebound. So much opportunity there. Finley has the ball, she's back in for the point is. Now Rocker gets it over to Finley, excuse me, to Pokey. Pokey in the Peacock, and the other ball, nice throw by Mahal, stolen by Bart, nice throw by Mahal. Now out to Marlboro. Third move is looking to go in the front court, that comes to power. Gets it ahead, but Bart brings it to Tyson Benny Reese, but Bart, and still kicks out to Marlboro, and what is it to do? Let's get down! He's trying to come around. That's his second free throw of the game. He's the winning score for the Red Eagles and the first play in the game in double figures for 12 points. But the 45-39 is a grand pass of defense. Down here to the field. The field takes that shot. He's just about Maribel in the hole, excuse me. Got Maribel with the bag. Red Eagles is starting to get her in as he's tired bringing in the front court. I think quite frankly, no coincidence since he's a pass kept in. Down the hole. Whips it over to Paige Marger. Marger takes over to Bart. Bob Marger is kicked from the cross with five, looking to draw. The three with two shots, the shooter with one. Parsons are really shot, no good, after the buzzer. So a shot back violation on the Gold Eagles. So Marger just got better and better, and the teammates did not help her out. As Kansas checks in the game, she kind of took down. So the Pioneers once again bring it up to 5:39 remaining in this second half. That's the Pokey, over the Rocker, she's bumped by Parsons on a foul throw. That's Parsons' foul, and it's a 10-team foul. Pass to the row, so that'll be 2 free throws for Rocker. And that's after the first foul on Drew Parsons, so it's doubly costly. So that George is going to call a timeout and talk it over with their team. They just took a timeout at 5:30 in the morning, Cats get over the 6-point lead. This is Cats get over women's basketball. 5:30 in the second half, Michael Walker go to the line to shoot two. So the point is, I've lived with the free throw line in the second half as he makes the free throw. Pretty incredible when you think the Pioneers have 18 points in this second half. And 10 of them are from the, excuse me, 11 of them are from the free throw line. As the first missed free throw of the half right there by the Pioneers, so 11 of 12 in this half, that's 25-40. Quickly throws the pass, picks up the whistle bell. He passes Paige Marver in the second half, that's going to go over. The pass is out there at 45, and that's just with their fifth foul. So they take the first half, and that's just for Duke Parsons. So Parsons flies out of the game. He's having a nice game off the bench. He had 5 points. Too bad. He's still got 8 minutes. Maybe only two shots. Including a 3-pointer. Two of those shots just in for Parsons. And the team in Jared Jones goes back to Destiny Rock on Plains. Just over 5 minutes left. He's going to get some perfect pressure there. Up by five. Now Rock has just put over to the series. In the corner of the series. He's two defenders dead. Rock against Pepper at times. Get the fuck out of the house. He's going to lose in a turnover. Now Lopez gets over the corner of him. Then he goes there. Jared Jones really cranking up the defense here. Now Lopez rips it over the corner of him. 4 seconds on the clock, over the corner for three, no good. That was by Michael Walker, and thankfully with the rebound. Just in all the games of power, stepping on the front court. And the goal leader will reset with 4:40 in the second half. This game taken up to be a very similar final score to the game up on Hayward in December. Remember that was 51-47 past that hour. This one along those same lines is dead in there. Picked it up, no good, but still got it around to keep three. That was the 18th foul on the Pioneers that Bart was shooting. First foul on the series, so the Pioneers were fouled several of their own. But he was one of keeping the people on air when he goes back. Broke the free throw. So Tucson comes back in with those four fouls. The series was took down. So both of those players with 4 fouls. The free throw, bounces, bounces, and where's going? So two big free throws for Ripple Park. Very nice part of the game. Makes it 40-40. This Budge had the best week offense of any player on the Golden Eagles. She had two good games on the road. As Phillips puts that up and bounces 3 times and goes in. And as soon as you get there, they're going to come out if you're a basketball player. Then it's the 47-42. It's a 30-second timeout. So it's going to pass through the Castleberry touchdown here. As I said, a little bit, as the best week of any player last week, they had a season high time 13 points in the position San Diego in the game last Saturday to go to the rest. That's a 9 points with Stafford San Diego on Friday. That's exactly what she has right now. 9 points to go around with 4 rebounds in 31 minutes. So she got Paige Madwell for most minutes played on Cat State alone. As the players quickly break together. So for the Pioneers players out there with Tucson, Finnegan, Lopez, and Walker, they took with their pressure, Belt gets in to prove the power out there to send it out, Paige Madwell and see a front throw. Quickly in the front court, Paul Easley breaks it, and now Madwell will reset with 4 minutes to go for the second half. Now Paige the power. Go for the team of fan throw. Now Belt. Start looking for some of the girls who bumped and fired by Michael Walker. So Belt will go right up to the free throw line, which is made two. So first foul on Walker, so that's 3 points for the Pioneers with 4 fouls left. And Belt looking to be the second goal move on double figures, and he makes the free throw on the 1-1. That was only the 19 foul. Big free throw there by Belt. So his senior leader, Ripple Belt, with 5th year in Castle LA, is heading to big down the stretch. And she makes the first free throw in a row, 49-43. And Lopez will bring in the front court, holding the reestablishing a 7-point lead. So they're holding the Pioneers with Barry at the free throw line on that thanks to Ripple Belt. And Lopez drives the baseline, takes that lead for Tucson. She runs over the hair, no power. Picks up a shot, no good. That is the reset. Goes up to Walker, Moves like that, hard ball, that was a quick, hard ball, but luckily for the Bears, Moves, because that's where those two crossed the line. So they will get the ball at 3:30 remaining. So Bears will bring it in. Look what Kessler is into the hair. Probably to close the tie. But Kessler and Powell goes up in the hair. Powell brings in the front court, brings up to close the hair goal. Bears Moves don't want to sit on this lead. They're still too much time left. But they don't want to take this cross either. As Margo, just the way this one's going, I don't think that's their big problem. The foul is called inside. There have been two more free throws. John Raffles, so that's what they are. That's their first foul. So if he becomes the first pass, they'll be third foul to foul out in the game. So Raffles fouls out. With 5 points on the game, all from the free throw line, and also two rebounds in 19 minutes. Fanfare rolls in the first free throw. So, Tina Fanfare to the line. So, Fanfare misses the second free throw. Those are the 15 free throws of the game. They're right up and in on the other end by Terry the Fury. That touch is a trick. That butt puts him in the front court. Gets over to the fan fall. Under 4 minutes to go. There's a foul. Gets it over. Not the way Bart Whitley gets it. First turned over. Oh, it's a foul. Bart rolls it up and rolls it into the foul. Great pass by Bart Whitley. Bart Whitley rolls it through the foul. Once he gets the foul, Bart Whitley still runs traveling. But they did not get it. And there's a foul going around. Trying to turn the lead back to nine. So, boy, there are two big stories here in this second half of the Golden Eagles. They look at that. Clutch free throws, and then once there's a pass, they're into the game. Order is destroyed. Golden Eagles stop turning the ball over. And start getting the lead back up. But Paige Marbury also had a very nice second half. He had 9 of the points in the second half. And Powell makes the free throw. So, 3 points, if you will, in the second half. Along the first, the Golden Eagles, great defense. And it's a 52-44, 7 points to Paige Powell. Then they're the pizza line, underneath the chance. Chance, 3 second violation. So, big ball there. Another chance is the top 30 play. So, the Golden Eagles are in down the ball to see the free throw. And the football class time out. I don't know if there was a practice or what the deal was, but they needed to get the inbound the ball. Hit the ball just in the third of the ball. Paul took the shoot of thunder. Nice play there. Hits that pitch in the air. And perfect the loose corner. Not a good shot. That was too early in the clock. That coming the other way was Walker. Walker gets it over for Sikoki. That's the route to Sikoki, excuse me. Pull up 16 foot on the baseline to Lambert. To track it on the head, get the lead out to see the Fanfare. Fanfare, 3 pounders are back to circle the center of pitching it. To get the same pass from Paige Marger. Now over to Paige Power. The teammate across Paige Power will hold the ball. Over to Lahaire. Lahaire, back to Power. 150 remaining. 8 seconds on the shot clock. Powell looks and grabs the baseline and she was fouled with 6 seconds on the shot clock for a big throw there. And she was going to take her on two crew. Powell got four of them. That's her first foul. But we're going to beat that. She would have fouled out. So Paige of Powell goes back to the free throw line. And she just got a big 3-point throw. He set the shot and rolls the free throw around on out. That was pretty. That's Washington. They take first to pitch. 5 points off from Battlegrounds, Washington. And two points took down. That's an interesting stat. Minute 47 left in the game. Powell misses the free throw. Of course, that may be to commit fouls, too. Number two point has 4 fouls. Washington hasn't played in the game, so he may be in there to commit fouls if the foul looks for a basket here. Paul Lopez gets over to Finnegan, pulls up to Finnegan, they're good. Long with the lead out, goes back to Finnegan. Finnegan. Oh, he's up to work quickly, in there to Taylor. That's about not to by Norgrove, throwing down the hill. That's to do the front throw. That's to close Norgrove, took the Pioneers foul in the front break, 2-on-1. And off the back, but there's an operation in him. That's what a beat to pass right there. They're moving a good job there. That's 2-on-1 Redick to make it 55-44. That looks like. Front break goes out of the way, raises it up, and an offensive foul. The hill takes the foul. So very nice defense by the Bears Eagles. Bears Eagles had a great defensive display against the Pioneers in their first meeting this year. And I like the Bears to address until this may be their best defensive performance of the year. They have really been fired for the entire 40 minutes here defensively. Rarely any breakdowns in this game. There's a rough spot on the floor that they have to clean up. Now the Bears Eagles will come down to Marlboro. Norbert falls down in the corner, but not too early. And the foul is fouled. See, they called a foul on him. As Norbert was about to fall, boy, he got knocked over. If he ran again, someone fell over. He ran down, hopefully he's okay. Someone might have landed him. Hopefully not on his head. He's going up slowly. So that's the first time the foul on the Pioneers on front of him. So he's the second time he's trying to fall off. That's the first foul. So 59.9 seconds remaining, Paige Barber will make a free throw line after she kicked off the cobwebs to keep free. Well, number two comes into the Pioneers, Leon Willingham, transfer freshman from Palmer, Washington. So Pioneers going with a couple of players they haven't played in this game. So Barber going to the line. He's got a very good second half. One of the 4 points in the second half. He looks to Abdul at the free throw line. He got to find the free throw. So, Marvel looking to creep up toward the season average at this point today. That's the down. That's a 57-44. Now in the front court, Kentucky. Gets it over. Lopez gets it knocked away, but a foul is called. To get the foul on. Here's the foul, first third foul. Of course, the Golden Eagles do not want to stop the clock off a 13-point lead. 51 second left. Lopez makes the free throw. So, if you have to go past the lane, it's going to get out of here with a victory, and this could be a huge victory indeed. I think the Golden Eagles are going to win game to catch these players. That's what they're good. That's the 57-40. That Melville is coming around to change the foul. Here's a tie in the first place. Gives it out to Peter Francisco. Don't play over the Paige Marvel. Goes into the red time down and now a foul, a weekend foul by Lopez. So Lopez fouls out also, a paper foul. So Paige Marvel will go to the line. Looking to get a season average here. So, Paige Marvel going to the free throw line. So, she just made two free throws and she missed that one. So, Marvel looking to make it a 4-point third legal lead. And she does. In the front court, the Pioneer Tiger, 30 seconds left. So, Finley whips it over to Kentucky. Kentucky in there to Kane. Got a 3-pointer on the way, is good by Finley. 2 minutes to catch for each throw, 58-49. Got that with 20 seconds left after Marlboro. Marlboro in the front left of the head, 2-1. And you can see the front throw is tight by Sanford. She backs it out. And the Golden Eagles are running the clock out with 10 seconds. Pioneers will not foul. That's for good. The fans give the Golden Eagles a well-deserved round of applause. And the final score, Open Eagle, that's the pass for our Golden Eagles. Chris Fuchs, the pass for Eastern Pioneers, 58-49. That's what AME and teams 11 and 6, or even 5 in the CCRA. That's 34 and 5 to 12 and 8 on the road, 9 and 4 in the CCRA. Number 2 of those 4 losses are the Cal State LA. So as far as the Catholic standings go, that means Cal State LA with that win, teams 8 and 5. They're still a couple of teams ahead of them, just passing them over to the UC San Diego. Unfortunately, I'm not able to get scores of the games right now. But if one of those teams loses the game, they could move up into a tie. So if third place or even third place, they're going to decide to super third on Santa Claus at the beginning of the game. That's what he's doing, maybe. It was in second place, so this win leads the Golden Eagles to within one game in the second place in the conference. As the forwards lead the pick, a power guard got stopped by the last round, so you may have been able to pass. So let's see if we can get the final stop. So, oh, here we go. So, I got it. So let's get the stats quickly for John this one. For the Golden Eagles, they shot 17 to 39, 43%. Panthers only 14 to 52, 27% in the game. Panthers only 43 points. The Golden Eagles were 6 to 14 from that end. Golden Eagles only 18 to 32 from the free throw line. Luckily, they didn't need all of them. Panthers were 17 to 21 from the free throw line, so they made good on most of their opportunities. Rebounding was about even, 37 to 36. First turnovers going over a 10 of them, 21 to 20. The Golden Eagles are 21 turnovers in the Pioneers 20. So, a lot of turnovers in this one. Both turns are about even, 13 to 12 in favor of Cal State East Bay. Fourth and the third are also even, 16-14 in favor of East Bay. Golden Eagles led by as many as 14 points. Pioneers led in the first half, but they did not lead in the second half. Now, the Golden Eagles led the entire second half. That was the first, second year, that had to go to the Pioneers with 11 points. The Pioneers had 9 points. The Pioneers had 2 had 10 points. The Pioneers had 2 points, 8 points and 10 rebounds, the first 2-5 out. Michael Rappin had 5 points. Both were 30 games in the third quarter, that's 8 points. First half, 4 rounds. They were led to try to face back to 8 Marvel, once again with 15 points. They were out of 2 rebounds. Both the Pioneers, the only other game with a 10 and double figures with 15 points. Henry Severs had 9 points. Cain DePaul had 7 points. Lee Parsons had 5 points. And Gordon Williams was trying to hold. Dustin Rock on 3 now had 2 points. That's the first goal. He was like, because he wasn't 5 covers. The player leads to a 4 point and Iowa comes there. Iowa with 1 point. So everybody was in the game score to cut 4 first down play. So Iowa got good. He's from Eagles left. So if the catcher starts this weekend, the catcher will be able to move on to first catcher now or day tomorrow night. That'll be our next broadcast, the women's broadcast, here on the Catcher Royal Best Network. So stay tuned, though, because the men's game is getting ready to start. They're pretty soon. They're on the court and getting ready, so I'll be back in about 10 or 15 minutes with the start of that game. So that's the only way. Here's the Catcher Royal Women's Basketball, where the Golden Eagles, the first catcher, will score 58 to 49. I'll be back in a little bit, everybody.